here to have a memorial service. Brother Charles Harold Fuller, born July 12, 1946, and left this old world July 21st. When I think about a memorial service, I think about memories. And I think about this family. Been knowing y'all about 20 years now. You know, Brother Ronnie started the church with me when I first started the church in 2002. On the rides that we would have, brought Brother Charles. And then I remember it was shortly after that, we had a snowstorm come in, a tree fell on Charles's house. Some of us was over there, Brian, that's where I met you first, cutting a tree off his house. And over the years, our kids played sports together, and we just began to know one another. It's a beautiful family, all of you. All of you, wonderful, wonderful people. I thought about what I might share today. It was a scripture that comes from the book of John. Chapter 14, that we read at services like this many times. It says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you." He says, "But I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Where I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, or how we know the way." And Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to me except through the Father. To the Father except through me," Jesus said. And you know, I think about the relationship that Charles had with the Lord. I think about what he's been through over the last several years. Ever since his motorcycle accident, he's really struggled. It's been hard. The times when he'd come into church there, he always come in and sit on the very back row. Just as soon as you walk in the door, the last seat right back there, he'd sit right there. And I always go talk to him. And he's, for the last year, said, "I just hurt, preacher. I just hurt. Hurt all of them." And so I think that we kind of knew that his day was coming and coming soon. But the one thing that I was sure of, that he was ready. Yes. He was ready to see the Lord. And you know, there's evidence that we can look for. In the book of Matthew, he tells us that we are the salt of the earth. He says, "If the earth, if the salt loses its flavor, how will the earth be flavored?" You know, I watched his life over the years. From the time he worked at Quality Foods, listen, he was like on a mission there. You know, he didn't have to work there. He was on a mission. Those kids meant so much to him that he worked with, bagging groceries. There wasn't a one of them that he didn't help in some way or another. They needed anything, he was always there for them. And then, you know, ain't no secret, he loved to hang out at the Huddle House. That was his favorite little hangout there. But y'all, unless you saw him in there, he was always looking for somebody he could help. Ain't no telling how many people he bought food for in there. Ain't no telling how many people he gave rides, he did things for. And when you look at that, you see the love of God coming out of a man. A man that had the love of God in his heart. And that's all he wanted to do and be, was what God wanted him to be. And you know, there in the last little bit, he come in, he sat down on that back row, and Ricky Masters always sit with him. Ricky loved him, and they sat there and talked. And it was always about his family. Y'all, he loved y'all, every one of y'all. He loved you. He loved you more than you know. He was one of them, Fullers, they're kind of stubborn and hard-headed a little bit. And maybe Ronnie's the only one like that since he ain't here today. I tell you, his heart's breaking because he couldn't be here today because of the sickness that he's battling. But his heart broke that he couldn't be here. But we over the years, have seen that, you know, the love just poured out of Charles. If I could tell you one thing today, he loved you. And he loved everybody. And he wanted to help everybody. When you see that, you just see the love of God I didn't come today to preach a big old sermon. I come to share memories with you. And I think that's what he would want today, is for all of you to know that he loves you. And there's only one thing that's important, that if we know the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, and we're prepared and ready to go when he calls us. And y'all, when we look around at this world today and everything that's going on, if we open up this book and begin to read it for ourselves, don't take my word for it, don't take Brother Paul's word for it, and he'll tell you the same thing. Get in this book and know it for yourself. Because when I was going to church and listening to preachers, when I got in this book for myself, I found out there's a lot of things that I heard them say that wasn't in there. And there were some things they said that was a little twisted, so we need to learn it for ourselves and get in a personal relationship with the Lord God Almighty and be prepared for when he calls our number. Because he has gone and prepared a place. And when it's time in all of our lives, he's coming back to get us. And who knows, this might be the generation that the eastern skies bust open and we all leave at one time. It might just be. So let's just give our hearts ready. Let's just let the love of God come in and the Holy Spirit fill us up with the love of God and the passion of God, and be ready for when he calls us. But I'll tell you, I don't have to worry about Brother Charles. I know where he's at today. I know where he's at without a doubt. He's in the hands of the Lord, and all that pain and all that sickness is gone, and he's at perfect peace today with his Creator who loves him. I want to say God bless y'all. I love you. Thank you for allowing me to do this. I'm with Brother Charles and ask that I would do this, and I thank y'all for the opportunity to share, because he was a friend to me, and I love him. God bless y'all.
part of your family. That's something I would like to say about Charles, is that from the moment that I came a part of this family, he never treated me differently. He saw me for who I was, not someone they thought that I was. I remember sitting down with your dad, Brian, him telling me about being in Germany and how he learned how to weld. And he saw me welding one time. He said, "Boy, you're doing it wrong. let me show you how to do that. You ain't going to make all them swirls. You just pull straight down that line." I said, "Okay, Mr. Charles, whatever you say, buddy." And of course, we were using not his welder nor my welder. We was using Don's welder. At some point, both of us got electrocuted at least four times. I was trying to put that one piece of metal on to that piece of rod I was working on. He made my mother-in-law very happy. He would walk up the street just to see Miss Ellen. He became such a close companion and friend to my mother-in-law. He also loved my children. And they don't understand. But one day they will. And just like you, they have the opportunity to see Mr. Charles again. Because he's more alive right now than he's ever been. He's more alive right now than he's ever been. I want you to hear the words of the Apostle Paul as he was approaching death in 2 Timothy 4, verses 6 through 8. This is the Apostle Paul writing to his spiritual son. He says, "For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me that day. And not to me only, but unto all of them that love his appearing." I want you to think about that word, departure, for a moment. The Greek word in the text translated for departure is a term that's used by sailors quite often. And what it means is a time of releasing a ship. Paul's speaking of a ship that would be released from land to go free to set sail. At that time, when a ship would leave the harbor, people would gather at the harbor side and they would watch the ship until it sailed over the horizon. Have you ever done that before? Have you ever been there on a beach and actually saw a ship leave a harbor? And as it keeps going, it might be a massive ship, but eventually you don't see it no longer. And everybody on the shore is emotions, but that might be a family or a friend on that ship that's going across the sea. You may not see for a little while. Yet somewhere on the other side, guys, there's a harbor. If a ship sets sail, it's looking to land somewhere. So Mr. Charles might have set sail, but he sailed to another port. Now the Apostle Paul went on to share with the believers in Philippi these words in Philippians 1, 21 through 23. He says, "For me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I want not. For I am straight twist between the two, having the desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better." When the Apostle Paul originally wrote these words to the Philippians, guys, his circumstances was pretty bad. He was sitting in a prison cell and tied to a Roman soldier. Paul said, "I have a captive audience." I love his sense of humor. He had them. He couldn't go nowhere, you know. But he said, "Look, guys, it's so bad, really. I really want to leave out of here, but I'm staying because of you." But he was in prison. He was under house arrest in Rome, literally chained to a soldier. As a prisoner, yet this entire letter that Paul wrote shouts triumph and victory. It was filled with such words as joy and rejoicing. Charles lived these last months as a prisoner in his own body. He felt the heartaches and the pain. He felt the sickness coming on. He felt his life slipping away until that one day it finally gave way to the other side, to the other harbor. The Apostle Paul struggled with wanting to remain alive and point others to God, and with wanting to die and gain a heavenly reward. Beloved in Christ, as for a Christian, death is entering into a new harbor. Death is to gain. You see, today we're not crying and mourning because Charles is alive. Because he knew Jesus Christ as his Savior. We gain glorified, mortal lives, resurrected bodies. In this present body of clay, we are subject to all sorrows and tears. And let me tell you, Charles felt those in his lifetime. And thy life throws our way age, sickness, infirmities that attack us. And finally, this flesh, this clay house made of dust and earth will soon pass away as well. But for followers of Christ, in death and the resurrection, we gain a body that will never grow old, that will never see pain, and that will never die. Jesus said in John 11:25-26, Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this, will never die. Christians do not die. Children of God do not die. Jesus said himself in John 11:26, those who believe in me shall never die. Followers of Christ do not die. They sail to a new place, to a wonderful harbor. Christians simply change their residence. Amen. We're pilgrims in this land. We're not meant to stay here. When God created us in his image, he put something inside of us that needs to go back home one day. And that's where Charles is right now. He's home in the presence of Almighty God. I was reading just the other day, studying the Word, and Jesus said, for you'll be like me, and you'll have the victory, and you'll come and sit on the throne with me as I sit on the throne with my Father. I can just see Charles right now sitting on the throne with Jesus Christ. Amen. We're talking about Germany all over again. You know, we're talking about getting shot by that welder out there in that shop that looked like it was going to fall on us. But God knew what he was doing when he created Charles. Something precious, something wonderful, something strong, something to be admired. So may we finish this race, this marathon of life, and may we finish it well. And we can look across to the other side. And as our boat comes into the harbor, Charles will be standing there, waving us in, celebrating you making it home. Let us pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for Charles Fuller, Father. God, we thank you most of all, Father, for he's not dead today, but he's alive. God, with a new body, Father, Lord, a resurrected body, God. The Bible tells us to be absent from the body is to be in the presence of God. So, God, we know that he's there with you now. So, Father, we thank you, God, that you've made a way where there seems to be no way. But, Lord, today, Father, if there's anyone here that, God, that doesn't know you as their Savior, God, the only way they'll be able to see Charles again is, Lord, by getting it right with you. God, Lord, you make it very simple, Father, in Romans. You say, Lord, for if we were confessed with our mouth, the Lord Jesus Christ, and believe with all of our heart that you raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. God, it's that simple, Father. There's no hoops to jump through, God. It's a free gift, according to Ephesians chapter 2, that we're saved by grace alone. So, God, today, Lord, let it be the day, Father, if they do not know you as their Savior, let them give their life to you. In Jesus' holy name, and everyone said, oh, yeah.
you were.